Welcome back to my channel. If you're new here, welcome. And if you've been here before, welcome back, welcome back. What's up, what's up? Hey, so as you all know, I made this super, super huge career change. I went from being a teacher and I am now a flight attendant. I have not started flying yet. You know, it's a process, but that's actually what I'm gonna talk to you about today. I wanna talk to you about how to become a flight attendant. I know, right? It's so exciting. So I'm just gonna take you through my process and how it went for me. Give you some tips, all that good stuff, and then, you know, send it right on your way so that you can too become a flight attendant. How to become a flight attendant. So your first order of business is you need to look at what airlines are hiring. Now, some people are more selective for what airline they want to work for. You know, some people are like, I only want to work for United, I only want to work for Delta, I only want to work for Southwest, which are all what we call mainline carriers. So they are the company, right? But me, I currently am employed with a regional carrier. With regional carriers, the main purpose for them is to get people to and from their destinations, but from smaller cities. If you've ever flown for Southwest, you will see that they don't fly everywhere, right? No airline flies everywhere, which can be quite frustrating, especially when you have a favorite airline. So that's just the difference between a mainline carrier versus a regional airline. Both are great. Both are gonna get the job done. It's all up to your personal preference. So step one is to figure out who you want to work for. Once you figure out who you want to work for, you actually have to apply. So, you know, click on the application, fill it out, and apply. Now we are in COVID times, right? So my process, I did a virtual interview. So after I put my application in, I got an email back like, hey, we would like to interview you. I signed on and I had to do a virtual interview. And my initial thinking was that I was going to be like on Zoom or like Microsoft Teams or something of that nature. And I would be actually physically talking to people. Most of the time it's easier for your personality to come out when you're having like a normal conversation with people versus talking to a camera, right? But it did not go like that. I had to do a virtual interview where it was more of me recording myself answering questions, and then I had to submit them. The nice thing about virtual interviews is that I had the time to preview the question, think about my answer, think about how I was going to deliver my answer, because having a great answer, you know, that's good, but it's also in the delivery. Are you delivering your answers like this, or are you loud and proud and you're there, like your presence is there, you know what I mean? So that was nice. I got to think about my answers, and then I also got a redo. So pretty much if I watched my first recording and I was like, butchered that, I did have one other option to record, which I think is a little better than having an in-person interview, because if you're in front of the person, you get flustered. They caught all your flusteredness. They caught you like mini panicking and all of that. So I personally like the process of a virtual interview. Some interview tips that I would share with you would be, one, make sure that your personality shows. Be happy, be bubbly, and make sure you smile. It may be weird because, like I said, you're just talking to a camera, but imagine that you have a whole audience. You are Beyonce and they are the people, and they're waiting to see your performance. So put it on. I would also say my next interview tip would be to make sure that you answer questions directly. Don't beat around the bush. I'm more of a, okay, if you ask me X, Y, and Z, my answer is L, M, N, O, P. And then moving on, you want to add some examples in there. So working in the airline industry or in the aviation industry, it's really customer service based. So because it's customer service based, you want to shed so much light on your customer service experience. I don't care if you just had that one job and you were the clerk at 7-Eleven, it was the best job ever. You helped so many customers and it helped your customer service experience, right? You want to play it up. Even if it was something where you feel like, oh my gosh, this doesn't matter, play it up. Make sure that you give good examples that coincide with the question and they play really big on your customer service. Now, see, my resume recently is all teaching stuff, but that's not customer service, but it is people related. So I get to show my relations and how I handle different people, because I'm not handling customers, but I have to handle kids, parents, staff members, other teachers, teachers from other schools, when you're at professional development, so on and so forth. So the experience is there. I also do have a lot of customer service. I've worked in food, I've worked in retail. So I had the experience. But if you don't have the experience, use something that you have done that is highly relatable to customer service or something like it. Make sure that you smile. Don't go into your interview like this and just be like, yo, it's whatever. It's not whatever. If you want the job, you need to act like you want the job. You feel me? Like, just make it seem like you want to be there. Because some people like show up and they're just like, I don't care. Like, if you actually want the job, make sure it shows that you care. My last interview tip would be to dress the part. You have seen many flight attendants, and I'm not saying you have to go in there full face of makeup or go on the screen full face of makeup with the scarf and the blazer, but make sure you dress the part. You want to make sure that you look business professional in your interview. You want to make sure that your hair is done. Like in my interview, I had my natural curls out. My hair was big, but it also looked tamed. It was moisturized. It was in place, but it was still big and natural how I like to wear it, because I wanted to go into the interview personally like, this is who I am. Although my hair is straight right now. Like, this is who I am. We have found the airline we want to work for. We have submitted an application and we have interviewed. After your interview, if they do accept you, you're going to get something called a CJO, which stands for a conditional job offer. That means they're offering the job, but you don't actually have the job yet. It's just an offer, which can be rescinded at any time. So don't go around like, oh, I'm a flight attendant just because you got a CJO. You are not. You still got to get through some hoops. Once you get your CJO, it's like, okay, you start getting information about when you go to training and all that good stuff. So I don't know the training process for every airline because I am not an aviation nerd. I do like to travel, but I don't know all the ins and outs and whatever. But most people or most companies, they have training for at least from, let's say, 3 to 5 weeks. Some airlines are longer than 5 weeks, but I haven't seen anyone who has trained in less than 3 weeks. I probably personally wouldn't trust it. Because when I'm learning in 2 weeks, like, it gives a little bit of cringe, you know what I'm saying? So you get your CJO and then you head off to training. Again, the length of training could be any other time. So let's say you go through training and you are successful. Woohoo, you made it through training. But it's more like a phase one of training, because most airlines, you have to do your ground training and then you move on to your in-flight training, or what we call an IOE, which is your initial operating experience. Now, that training is the hands-on. I'm on the airplane. I'm with real people, not my classmates. Like, this is it. This is the job. That is the true test of, can you take the information you learned in ground training, right, and then apply it to what you're actually doing, like the actual job on the aircraft. Once you successfully complete ground training and your IOE, now you successfully 100% have the job, okay? So now, after you do that, you can just be in the friendly skies, doing what you do best, traveling on your days off, and, you know, making a deal with it. You live your life in the sky, and then the rest is history. You really get to figure out if you like it or not, and if it's not for you, don't be ashamed to say that. Me right now, I have not completed my IOE yet. I haven't even gotten my IOE date yet. But I've still been studying, looking over everything that I would need to do for my IOE. To sum it up though, to become a flight attendant, it's actually fairly simple. You apply, or you find your airline, you apply, you interview, you get a CJO, you do ground training, you do your in-flight training, and then you live a life in the skies. Is training rigorous? Yes. Is training difficult? I would say yes. Can you survive it? Can you do it? You sure can. So if you want to be a flight attendant, this is my quick crash course on how to get a job. Just make sure you harp on that customer service experience, or any experience that you have that is similar to customer service experience. Make sure you smile. Make sure you show your personality. Stay strong through training and you got this. But that is all I have for you guys today. So thank you for watching, and I will see you in my next video.